idea of what kind of questions are asked in this field of extremal problems in combinatorial geometry. So I will not go too deeply into the proofs, just to give you some general flavor of the questions and also the tools that are used or developed while trying to solve these problems. So I will go through several examples. I chose these examples because they are very typical and they are kind of classical in the field, and also because recently in the last 10 years there was progress in this in these problems. So we'll start with the question of Erdős about distinct distances. So Erdős asked this in 1946. So the question is this: you're in the plane in R2, you have n points, and these points you can look at their distances, pairwise distances between the points, and he asked how few distances can a set of n points determine. So let Fn be the minimal number of distinct distances determined by a set of n points in the plane. And he asked how small can Fn be. So he showed in his paper from 1946 that Fn is at least, when I write this, this means up to a constant. So we care about the function as n goes to infinity. So up to a constant, he showed that this is at most n to n over square root of log n, and at least root of n. Okay, so I'm going to talk about what happened with this lower bound. But in order to show the upper bound, so you just need some example to show that there is an example of n points, actually a sequence of examples. For every n, you need such an example of n points that induce this number of distinct distances. So the example was just the integer grid, the square root n over square root n integer grid. Of course, all these points. Okay, so if you look at this set, what are the distances here? So the distances, actually, it's the same as asking what is the number of solutions, of integer solutions, of the equation u squared plus v squared equals w, where w is between 1 to 2n. Okay? And this was known, and this is the number. So there is some constant here, and this is more than now. So this is the example that he gave, and he thought that this is the as few as possible, or at least asymptotically, this should be the number, and one cannot find another set of points in the plane with fewer distinct distances. Okay, so is the problem clear? Okay, and since then, but he could not prove also the upper one. He could not prove that any set of n points in the plane has at least this number of distinct distances. So people tried to improve his lower bound. And so, okay. So there were many tries. So in 1952, Moser improved the lower bound to be n to 2/3. And in 1984, Chang proved n to 5 over 7. And in 1992, so I'm going to write the list of 2001. So in 1992, Chang and Samaradin Trotter proved n to 5 over 5. Over log n, and then Seke improved it to n to 4 over 5. So for some reason, people worked on this strange looking problem. And so Seke improved to n to 4 over 5. And then, OK, I'll just read it. In 2001, Sharmushi and Toth proved n to 6 over 7. And then Tardosh proved n to, so OK, now it's getting complicated, so I'll write it. So Tardosh proved in 2003 n to 4e divided by 5e minus 1 minus epsilon. And then in 2004, Katz and Tardosh proved n to 48 minus 14e divided by, okay, you get the idea, right? 55 minus 16e minus epsilon. And then finally, in 2011, so Guten Katz. So as you can see, the bounds here, we expect something, or Erdős expected something close to n. So the exponent should be, so maybe not the square root log n, but the exponent, we expect it to be 1, and it's not really, it looks very, very far. And then in 2011, so the paper actually came out later, but they uploaded it on the archive in 2011. So Guth and Katz proved something very, very close to the conjecture, so n over log n. So this was
Jens for an unusual acknowledgement. Katz acknowledges the pond.
I'm sorry?
You read the acknowledgement in the paper.
Oh, so they
Katz came here.
Okay.
And he acknowledges the pond. Nothing else.
The
pond.
Acknowledgement. So you say that it's even. Okay.
You expect
something I didn't know. Okay. So this considered like a huge progress and surprise. And also in their paper, they developed many tools that affected later all this field and all these questions that are considered combinatorial geometric questions. So let me tell you, so I'm not going to go deeply into any of this. I mean, I just really want to briefly mention this question. But let me just tell you a little bit about what happened before this result, and to show you some, to tell you something about the proof. So what happened here that helped this result to come out is, first of all, the result of Zev Dvir in 2008. I don't know, probably you know. I wrote 8, okay. So Zev Dvir's solution to the Kakeya, so Dvir's solution to the finite field Kakeya. So again, very, very briefly, so what is a Kakeya set? You have a subset of F to n, so this is some finite field size q. You look at this vector space, you want a subset of it that contains a line in any direction. And you would like to show that if you have this kind of set, then it has to be large. And his idea was, let's take all the points and put them on a zero set of a polynomial. And if this set is small, then we can find such a polynomial of relatively small degree. And on the other hand, if such a polynomial would contain a line in each direction, it will have to be identically zero, and then it's a contradiction, and then this means that this set should be large. So this is the idea here. And then later, this is very quick, but it's supposed to be like, just to give you some idea about the proof. And then later in 2008, there was another breakthrough of Guth and Katz that proved the joints conjecture or solve the joints problem. So what is this problem? So you have n lines in R3, and a joint, if you have a set like this, a joint is a triple of lines that go through a common point, so they are concurrent, and these points are not coplanar, so they span R3. Okay, these directions span R3. And the question is, how many such joints can appear in a set? What is the maximal number of joints that can appear in a set of n lines in R3? So the conjecture was n to 3 over 2, and they proved it. And the idea was inspired by Dvir's solution. So the idea was, let's look at all these points that form. So we have n lines in R3. Look at all the points that are joints, all the joints formed by this set. And let's put them on a zero set of a polynomial in R3. So you have a two-dimensional algebraic surface. So if we know how many points there are, we can say something about the degree of this polynomial. And on the other hand, if each line contains many points, many such points, many such joints, then it will have to be contained in the surface. But then if all these lines are contained in the surface, so if we have a joint, then this point has three lines contained in the surface and that span R3. So it means that this is a singular point. So now you have many singular points, but if the line contains many singular points, then it has to be contained in a sub-variety of lower dimension, one-dimensional variety, a curve in R3 that contains all the singular points of the surface. But now we have a bound on the degree of this sub-variety, so we get a bound on the number of lines. But we know how many lines, so this gives you some connection between the number of lines and the singular and the number of joints. So again, this is very just to say something. And then so how is this related to the question about distinct distances? So then came out an idea of Elekesh. I mean the years are, I'm just making them up more. So 2010. So there was an idea of Elekesh that later developed by Elekesh and Sharir on how to reduce this problem about distinct distances to a question about contact points of lines in R3. So maybe I don't want to spend too much time on this. So they had a reduction to a problem about lines in R3. And then Guttenkatz, so they made some conjectures that if they were true, would almost prove the conjecture of Erdős. And then Guttenkatz were able to prove these conjectures. And they developed many tools while proving this. And one of them was something called the partition in polynomial, which allows you to partition. So if you are in RD, you have a set of points, you can find a polynomial of certain degree, and you can control the number of points contained in each cell. If you do that, so first of all, notice that here, all these results somehow apply in an arbitrary dimension. You can take a polynomial, you can take the points and put them on some polynomial, but here you need, this partition is something that is special to R and won't work, for example, over the complex numbers. So this is something to notice. So they could do that, and then some of the points would lie on the zero set, and then they handle it, taking some ideas from here. So okay, so this is really just to give you some taste of the kind of tools that were used for this proof. And then there is a related problem of Erdős from the same paper called the unit distance problem. Yeah, so there are analogs in our dimension. It's still open, I mean, much more open. I don't remember exactly the exponents, but somehow for this reduction, so this reduction was very special to the plane. And in our dimension, it doesn't work quite well, and then you cannot, so yes. Okay, so the unit distance problem is a similar one, but now we want to get to the same distance again and again. So in principle, it is very similar to here, right? If you want few distinct distances, then you would try to get the same distance again and again, but it's not equivalent. So he defined the Gn to be the maximal number of times distance 1 occur in a set of n points. I hope this formulation in R2. Okay, so this was the question, and he showed that Gn, so again, the example of the grid will give you one of the sides of this inequality. So n to 1 plus c over log log n. And it showed that it's at most n to 3 over 2. So this was improved in 84 by Spencer, Samardi, and Trotter. They showed that this, so in 84, they showed that this is at most n to 4 over 3. And since then, there was no really progress on this problem. And this, so the conjecture of Erdős was that this should be also the upper bound, so this should be more or less best possible, or that it should be close to n somehow, and still this is the best exponent that we know. So, and
The 2001 result, is that the first one where they use the structure of an algebraic variety?
So I'm not sure about this result, but certainly this, this
convexity of entropy.
Okay, so I mean this was invented especially for this problem. So
I don't have already explained it, I guess, but is there a simple reason why studying algebraic varieties helps for looking at distinct distances, or
why algebra?
I guess you may have kind of explained the connection.
Oh no, so I said that there is a step here that I didn't give the details about it, but I mean you mean about the reduction. So is it a philosophical question about why would distances be solved, or is it like a concrete question about how did they do this reduction? First of all, okay, so the concrete answer is that there was an idea, so this is the picture that belongs here. So Elekes had an idea on how to reduce the problem into a problem, into a question about contact points of lines in R3. So I can tell you roughly the idea, and the philosophical, I don't dare to answer the philosophical one. But so concretely what Elekes' idea was is that he regarded a point in R3 as an orientation preserving rigid motion of R2. So you need three parameters for that. And now you regret you asked the question, right? No, but I mean, his idea was, maybe I shouldn't do it, but too late for that. So if you have prime Q prime. So his idea was, first of all, so this is a general thing. So I'll tell you about this reduction. So the idea was, instead of counting how many distinct distances there are, let's count how many pairs of points there are that give the same distance. So a pair PQ and a pair P prime Q prime that give the same distance. Let's count this, and then using Cauchy-Schwarz, you can upper bound the number of distinct distances. And then in order to bound this quantity, he said, let's look at all the rigid motions of the plane. So what are these? When do we have such a quadruple, PQ and P prime Q prime? It happens if we have a rigid motion that takes P to P prime and also Q to Q prime. So if we have the same rigid motion, takes P to P prime and Q to Q prime, it exactly means that PQ is of the same distance, exactly like P prime and Q prime. So this is what you want. You regret for asking a question. So anyhow, he associated the pair P and P prime with all the rigid motions that takes P to P prime, which turned out to correspond somehow to a line in R3. And then Q and Q prime, again, he associated with them the family of rigid motions that take Q to Q prime, and then if the two sets intersect, it means that there is a rigid motion that take P to P prime and Q to Q prime. So this was good for everyone. I mean, it's not, don't feel guilty for that. But in general, I mean, okay, and now to the philosophical part. So, I mean, distances is something algebraic, right? So you can write some formula. Maybe the answer should come from the algebraic properties or things that in some cases, it comes from that. And okay, I don't know. I hope I answered. Okay. So here I don't want to spend too much time, but I will say why. So we have this problem. It is stuck for a long time, for more than 30 years, and maybe you would expect. I mean, they look so similar. Maybe you would expect that these methods, there are so many new tools that were developed here. Maybe they should help here. But there is some good intuition some good reasoning to think that the tools here will not work for this problem. Okay, so here is the reason. So if we look at you should be able to read. So if you look at this problem, one way to reformulate it is as we want to see how many pairs of distance 1 can appear in a set of n points in the plane. So let's take n points in the plane. And we can draw a circle of radius 1 centered at each of the points. So we'll get n circles of radius 1 in the plane. And we can look at the points, okay? So they have two. So we still have the endpoints. And whenever there is a point that lies on a circle, it exactly means that there is a pair of distance one that, that we had in the original set. Okay, so this is what's called an incidence problem. A more general incidence problem is when we have curves in the plane, we have points, and we want to know how many pairs, a point and a curve, there are, such as the point line on the curve. So this is a general problem. So the thing is that if we look at this problem with unit circles, we get the same bound. So instead of unit circles, we can take other curves. So if we'll take, for example, lines, we will get another incidence problem. And the same technique that was used in order to solve to get this bound of n to 4 over 3 is the one that works similarly to lines and to unit circles. So the same method works for lines and unit circles in the same way. So and the problem is that for lines, this bound is tight. So if you look at n points and n lines in the plane and look at the number of incidences, then you get n to 4 over 3, and this is tight. So you somehow want to make it different to say, OK, circles, unit circles, for some reason, are different from lines. So this should be. And in all the methods here, because they use varieties and degrees, and so you can hardly see any difference between a circle. As long as it is constant degree, then you don't really care. Instead of lines, you can take some constant degree curve. You don't care. But in this problem, we really want to say that lines and circles are different. So yes, OK. So this is why we think that one would need a new idea in order to solve this problem. So that's all I wanted to say. I want to switch to a.
You could imagine the lines and circles checking in some technique which doesn't give the optimal giving a different exponent.
So again, sorry?
The line is degree one, the circle is degree two.
Yeah, so you have curves of degree two that also, that it is tight. It looks like it's very specific, but.
So they are curves of degree two.
Yes, but I mean, yes, like parabolas, but okay. But they are not, you can, okay. So if you never heard about question of Erdős, so probably you know that he offered prizes, but I'll just read it to you so you won't leave this talk without knowing that. I mean, this is so, okay. So he wrote, so in a paper from 85, he re-mentioned these problems, and he said the determination of Fn or Gn are probably hopeless, and to get good upper and lower bounds for these functions is also very difficult. And I offered and offer $500 for a proof of or disproof of 2 and 3. So these are the reversed lower bounds. The reversed inequalities. And $250 for Gn to show that Gn is at most. So we think it should be more or less n, this number. But to show this with an epsilon, he offers $250. And the reason is, he says in brackets, Samaradi considers this perhaps attackable. I have made no progress on this problem since the paper from 46, and blah, blah, blah. But there is another thing that I want to say about this, and he asks it here, so I'll read it. So another question he raises here is it true that x, so if we have a point, if we have a point set that attains the minimum here, okay, so it has a minimal number of, we can find n points in the plane, and the number of these things, this is exactly the minimum. So can we say something about the structure of this set? So he asks, is it true that this point set has lattice structure? I really have no idea, and the problem is perhaps too vaguely stated. The first step would be to decide if there always is a line which contains root n of the points. And in fact, n to the epsilon instead of root n would already be interesting, a strong. So he really asks about the structure of the points. And people have tried and are still trying to show that there is some structure. So even here, even though we here more or less know the number, we know that it should be close to n, so the number of distinct distances cannot be fewer than n or n over log n. There's still the question of how do these sets look like? The sets that attain the minimum the minimum, how do they look like? Do they have a special structure? Of course, if we take a random set of endpoints in the plane, then all the distances will be distinct. So we expect to find some structure. Okay, and
So slightly weaker, and by the way, they did get the money for it anyway.
They got it, okay.
Okay. I witnessed that, you know, they got
okay.
the full payment.
So actually, even for less than n squared, you would expect some structure. No? But so there are results that tells you something like, if you have little o of n distinct distances, then the number of points that are contained in a line should be not too big. This is something that we know for something which is little o of n squared, which is reverse. But I don't know. These are his words. So okay. But even without knowing the number, you can assume that this is the minimal number and then try to show something. Okay. So the next problem, so the problems are in pairs. So now we'll talk about another pair of problems. So the first one is about ordinary lines. I'll continue with. Okay. Okay. No,
I think this was
okay.
When
Erdős
was alive.
Oh, yeah. It's probably his bank anyway.
Okay. So to another problem. So a question. There is this problem about ordinary lines. So it starts with a. So okay. Maybe I'll define an ordinary line. So if we have a set of n points. So P is n points in R2, everything is in R2. So an ordinary line is a line that contains exactly 2 points of the set, 2 points of P. So contains exactly 2 points of P. Okay, and so Sylvester asked, I don't have the number, if you have a point set of, you have n points in R2, not all of them on a common line, is it necessary that there will be at least one ordinary line? And the answer was, the answer is yes, and it was proved by Galay, which is called the Sylvester-Galay theorem, that there exists there's always exist at least one ordinary line, and one expects to find more, so a conjecture of Dirac and Motzkin is that there are at least, so from 1951, is that there are at least n over 2 ordinary lines, so the constant here matter to them, so maybe I'll write it as a question to make it similar to the other. So what is the minimal number possible of ordinary lines spanned by a set of endpoints in the plane, not all on a line. Okay, so this was the question, and they conjectured it to be n over 2. And maybe I should tell you from the start, so Green and Tao proved this up to a constant. They gave a very precise answer to this question. But let me, before that, let me formulate another related problem. This is not good. Right. I like it that we're not spoiled with the automatic. So, okay. So, related question called the orchard problem. So, orchard problem. asked by Jackson in a book from 1821 and Sylvester in 68, so a very old question. And it says we have endpoints in the plane. What is the number of what is the maximal number of tree rich lines? So what is the maximal number possible of tree rich? So tree rich means that, which means a line that contains exactly 3 points of p. Tree rich lines. Spanned by p. So they look related, because if you want to find a set which contains a small number of ordinary lines, so what would we do? We have n points. And now we look at a pair of points from this set. And we don't want it to be an ordinary line, so we have to put another point on the set. And now we have another pair of points, but we have to put another. So it makes sense that this would somehow imply that there are many tree-rich lines, so they look related. And here is a way to see connection between the problems. So let's denote by nk lines that contain k points of p for k at least 2. So we have this identity. So every pair of points from our set. So we have a set P of n points in the plane, and we look at the, so nk is the number of lines that contains exactly k points of this set. So every pair of points from this line, from this set, lie on some line counted here, right? So we can count the pairs in two ways. One way is that we have n choose two pairs, and another is by going through all the lines. So let's look at all the lines that contains exactly k points, and then look at all the pairs there. So k choose 2 is nk. So we have this identity. And this is, of course, at least n2 plus 3 times n3. So we're taking the first two terms, and this is that the others are non-negative. And so this gives us some inequality. So we can see from here that n2 is at most, so the number of ordinary lines is at most n choose 2 minus the number, 3 times the number of tree rich lines spanned by the set. So if we know, for example, that the number of tree rich lines is very large, so that this, the n squared over 2 is somehow cancelled by n3, so we know that the number of ordinary lines should be small. Okay, so we have this connection, and Green and Tao essentially proved very strong results about the first problem, about the problem with so my numbering is this one, about the problem with ordinary lines. And I will state you a weak version of the result. And then they were able to prove also some result about this question, but only if the number of tree rich lines is really the extreme one, the one that cancels this this term. Okay. And then okay, so I'll say, so theorem of Green Tao. So maybe I should say, so before their result, there were many constructions that show many examples where the number of ordinary lines and the number of tree rich lines were small or big. And in all of them, there was somehow involved the cubic curve. For some reason, in all of the examples, it was very convenient to put the points on a cubic curve. And then in their result, it turned out that this is essential, that these are the only results, and they showed that if you have few ordinary lines or really many tree-rich lines, then the points, or many, a large subset of the points must lie on a cubic curve. So I'll state this. So if P is a set of n points in the plane, and so n should be large enough, so n is at least some n0 that depends on k. I'll say what k is in a minute. And P spans at least kn ordinary lines, then all but at most some constant that depends on k of the points lies on a cubicer. Okay, and they have stronger results, but this is one of them, and this is what the one I need here, and they also proved the something about the maximum number of tree rich lines using this reduction. Okay, so I will not state it. So, but here, as you can see, they don't only get the precise numbers, exactly how many ordinary, what is the minimal number of ordinary lines possible. They also get a structure. How do these examples look like? Okay. So let me give you a taste of the proof. Okay, maybe I'll write it here. So to me, at least when I heard about it, the first thing, the mysterious part was to me, how did they put the point on a cubic curve? I mean, you have points in the plane, you have some properties, and how would you put them on, how would you show that many of them? So I'll give you like the first few steps, but that show, that gives some idea on how they do that. How do they put the points on the curve? So taste, like the really first few steps in the proof. So taste of Queen style proof. So what they did, they wanted to use Euler characteristic in the plane, in the projective plane. So they thought of, we have n points in the plane. They think of it as points in RP2. It's more convenient to them for some reason, and I'll do it. Two, so we have a set P of n points in the projective plane. And we can look, instead of points, we can take the dual points. So instead of a point P, we can look at the dual point P star, and instead of a line, we always have a dual. So the dual of a point is a line, and the dual of a line is a point. And the property is that if P lies on L, on the line L, then it exactly means that the point L star will lie on the line P star. So this is something which is standard. And then they said, okay, so let's look at the arrangement. Let's look at the arrangement of points and of lines that is induced by the dual, this dual set of lines. So they have lines that are actually all these P stars, okay? And they want to think of it as a drawing of a graph in the plane in order to use Euler characteristic. So so what they do is they think, so whenever there is a point that goes through at least two lines, this is a vertex of the arrangement. And they think of it as a drawing of a graph in the plane. So you need to check some things, but like for example that you don't have double edges, so every face is with at least three edges, and that you don't have an edge, a vertex like this. But it works okay, and one can use here, so if we look at the number of vertices and the number of edges and the number of faces, we have this identity that E minus, now I'll confuse, okay, I'll take for, so V minus E plus F equals 1, where V is the number of vertices, here is the number of edges, and F is the number of faces. Okay? But what is this? So what is V? So V is exactly all these points that go through at least two lines. What is it? It's, what is a point that goes through So the two lines is exactly a line that originally supported the 2 points of the set, of the original set. So it means that V is exactly the all the lines spanned by the points. So sum of n k. So k goes from 2. And what is the number of edges? So it's a standard thing to do. So twice the number of edges, you can sum over all the degrees of the vertices. Okay, but what is the degree of a vertex? So if a vertex lies on k lines, it means that it was a line that supported k points. And it also means that its degree will be twice the number of lines and twice the number of points that go through it. So it's exactly 2 times k nk. So this is another way to count the same thing. And finally, let's squeeze it in here. So f is twice, so again, 2e. We can all go over all the faces. So if ms is the number of faces bounded by with s edges on their boundary, then we count this s. And then each edge was counted twice because it supports exactly 2 faces. So we have this. And if you combine all of these together, you get this identity. So you get, so I'll try to be quick because there's a point, yeah, I want to get to something. So we get to this identity. So N2 is 3 plus sum over k goes from 4 to n, k minus 3. So they get this identity. And from this identity, already you can see that the number of ordinary lines is at least 3, because this is not negative. But you can get more. So one thing to note here is that here the summation, the index goes from 4 to n. It means that n3 does not appear here. And also m3 does not appear here. So you can express the number of ordinary lines by this expression, but it does not involve the number of Turing lines. Or the number of faces. Okay, and if we assume that the number of ordinary lines is small, is some constant times n, we can see that this identity more or less tells us we need to make this more precise to get the right numbers. But it shows us that the number of all the nk for k. 4 and for k larger than 3 is very small. And all the faces that have at least 4 edges on their boundary is also a small number. So in some sense, negligible number of the lines are 4 each and more, and negligible number of the faces have 4 edges on their boundary. And what did they do from it is that more or less if we took, so now again, we have a point set, n points in the plane, and we look at its dual arrangement. So we take, instead of a point, we took the dual line that corresponds to it. And the property that we know, what we assume is that the number of ordinary lines originally spanned by this point set is small, is at most k times n. And what they show here, they do something for this, is that there is a structure to this arrangement of dual lines. So what is the structure? So they conclude that after we take the dual, in some sense that I'm not making precise, they get something that they call triangular grid. And this triangular grid looks, I'll try to, let's see if it comes out right. So how is this related? So what we can see here is that every face in the arrangement, in this arrangement, is bounded by exactly 3 edges. And every vertex here is of degree 6. So degree six is exactly mean that it has three. So this corresponds to a three rich line, because three rich line is crossed by exactly three lines in the dual plane. So they have this. Okay, so this follows more or less than this from this. And now what I want to show you is the trick that allows them to deduce that many points. So suppose we have this structure, again they call it a triangular grid. And from this structure, they want to conclude that many of the points, the original point set, many of them lie on a cubic curve. Okay? So how to do that? So one thing that you should notice here is that if we take 6 points, this hexagon, and we go back to the primal configuration, what we will have is that these 6 points will correspond to 6 lines. You don't have to be parallel, but then, you know, it's easier for me to draw them like this. And the nine lines supporting these points will correspond to these 9 points. Okay. And then what they use is a theorem. I don't want to try to pronounce his name because I heard Ben Green pronounce it differently than well. So this person, there's an old, it's from 1885. So do you know how to pronounce his name? Chalet? Okay. So yeah, it reminds me that. Okay. Thanks. So Chalet theorem says that if we have such a point set, or if we have 9 points in the plane that are in the intersection of two sets of three lines, each set of three lines, so these are the 9 points. And if you have a cubic curve that goes through 8 of these points, then it must go through also the ninth point. So this is the property that they use. And now they use this grid. They start with some 9 points. They take a cubic curve that goes through these points. And then they can always add another point to the same cubic curve by this technique. So you can try. It's very confusing because the lines here are points. So it's confusing. We can try. So let's take, so let's say we want to add this line because we have here this hexagon. So we'll take here, okay, maybe because of the restriction of time, I will not do it. But it's possible. And so this was the trick. And after they have this structure, this grid structure, they were able just to collect all the points and put them on a cubic curve. And then there is a lot more and they get very precise results, but this is this is what I wanted to say about the proof. And so now one can ask what happens. So as I told you, for the orchard problem, what they showed is that if you have the maximal number of three rich lines, they get some structure about the point set. And there's a conjecture of, maybe I'll still write it here. So conjecture of Elakesh that says, and I heard Ben Green in his talks, he mentions it. And so conjecture. So suppose we have a point set in the plane, so we have n points in the plane, and we know that the number of three rich lines is at least some constant times n squared, but not necessarily the constant in Green and Tau got. So something very, very close to the maximal, but not necessarily the maximal one. So he conjectures that there exist 10 points that lie on a cubic. So 9 points is trivial, and he conjectures that there is at least one thing that, so there is some structure. For some reason, 10 points lie on a cubic curve. So this is something we don't know how to prove. And now in the little time that I have, I want to switch and talk about a simpler variant of this. Of these problems, an easier one. So now suppose, so here is a question. Now suppose a problem. We have now n points in the plane. They span some constant times n squared three rich lines. And now
n squared.
This is the three rich line, not the ordinary line. So this is a lot, almost the maximum. The maximum is 1/6, and this is some constant. But we have the extra information. So in general, we don't know how to say anything about the structure of this point set. But we have the additional information that the points lie on a constant degree algebraic curve. So they're not, it's not a general point set in the plane. So and the points lie on a constant degree algebraic curve. Okay, so this should be, so when I say constant degree, I mean n can go to infinity, but the degree is constant. So all the constants here can depend on the degree of the curve. So now we have a curve, and we have many points. So now let's say that this curve is irreducible. We expect, because we expect many of the points to be on a cubic curve, and this curve is irreducible, we expect this curve to be a cubic curve. Okay, so this is what we want to show. But still, it's very not clear how to get any structure. How to get any structure here, because we don't have this property that with this number of three-rich lines, we can have few ordinary lines, and then we can repeat. So one cannot repeat the argument of Green and Tau. Okay? So we can answer this question. But let me just to give you the idea here, I want to state something more general. So just to give you the idea, let me ask another question about distinct distances. So now we can ask the same question that we have n points lying on a constant degree algebraic curve, and we can look at the number, and we can ask how many distinct distances they can span. So here's a more concrete example. We have two lines in the plane. We have here n points and another set of n points, and let's look at the distances spanned by them. Let's say the pairwise, the bipartite version of the problem. Okay? So this looks very easy. We can write a formula for the distances. So if we have here a point T, 0, and here we have, let's say that this line is of the form y equals ax plus b, so this will be something like s and as plus b. So the distance between the two points is just t minus s squared plus as b squared. Right. So this is the distance. So it's a function of two variables, and our question is, let's take finite point set here of size n, finite point set here of size n, and we wanted the image, so choose A and B in R finite. Let's say each of them is of size n. So how small can the image be? So now let's look at the image. Can it be very small? Can we bound the number of, or okay, can we bound from below? Okay. Does it have to be large, or can it be very small? Or this is a short way of writing this question. So this specific function came from the problem of distinct distances on lines, but this is a general problem. We can take any polynomial of two variables and ask the same question. We want to choose two sets, finite sets, and look at its image and ask whether this image can be large. So fortunately, here we can answer this problem in general. So even though here we had two, I showed you like the distinct distance problem and the ordinary lines problem, they all look like very different, and the methods used for the proof were very different. Here, somehow, when we put the points on the curve, we get something unified. We have one tool that allows us to answer all kinds of questions of this form. So the idea here, I'll say it very quickly. So one example of a function that allows the image to be small is the following. If, for example, f of xy is just x plus y, we can always choose the sets a and b to be an arithmetic progression, for example, all the numbers between 1 to n. And we can choose the sets a and b to be each of them of size n, and the image will be roughly of size 2n. So it's small. Okay, you would expect more or less n squared things in the image because we have n squared pairs, and still the image can be very small. So this is one example. So, and another example will be x times y. But what we can show, so it was shown by Elekesh and Ronyai in 2000 with the worst bound, and then later in the work with Sharir and Shoemoshi. So what we showed, so this is more or less the only example. So every function of every polynomial of two variables, if one can find two sets such that the image is small, is O of n, then it must be either of the form P of x times Q of y and an outside function h. So here we can have either times or plus, minus.
Is it your polynomials of bounded degree again?
So we think of it as bounded degree and of the size of a and b that it can go to 50. And then the bounds will have a constant that would depend on the degree. And so what we show is that either the function, this polynomial of two variables, has this form, or the image has to be, so or for every a and b, f of ab is of size at least n to 4 over 3. Okay? So we get this dichotomy. So we know that the number of distinct distances, either it is very, I hope I can steal like 3 minutes because I'm going to steal 3 minutes. Okay, so either the image is very large, or otherwise we have a structure of the function. We know that the function looks like a certain thing. So we cannot have anything very close to. So I mean, if we have the number of distinct distances, for example, if we take this concrete function, if we know the number of distinct distances is smaller than n to 4 over 3, everything is up to a constant. Smaller than n to 4 over 3, we know that one can choose sets to make the number of distinct distances actually linear in n. Okay, so this is a result. This gives something, this tells us something about the function. But this does not finish as, I mean, this still does not answer this concrete problem, right? Because what we have here, we have a function of two variables, and we need to decide between two cases. Maybe the image, maybe the number of distinct distances spent here is at least n to 4 over 3. Or maybe we're in the other case, maybe this function can be written in this form. From that is more or less x plus y or t plus s, and then we know that the number of distinct distances can be small. Okay, so after we get this structure, we can look at the concrete problem and then try to analyze it and understand in what cases we are in the first option and what cases we are in the second one. So here, if one analyzes this example with the lines, one can see that. It's not hard to show that if the lines are orthogonal or parallel, then one can choose points so that the number of distinct distances is small. And otherwise, so for this example, the number of distinct distances must be large, must be at least n to 4 over 3. By the way, it's not clear if n to 4 over 3 is tight. I think that the common conjecture is that it should be more or less n squared. But this is what we know. This is the thing that we know to show, even though it looks like a simple problem. So just one word about this question. So here we have a more general version of this result. So we have here, this is really the last thing that I'm going to say. So we have here this curve. It's a constant degree curve. And we're interested in 3 points that lie on the curve that are collinear. So this, again, can be expressed by some algebraic equation. And since a point on the curve can be described by one parameter, we can get something like we have a polynomial of three variables. We look at its zero set. And the way we interpret it is that each variable here corresponds to a point on the curve. And this polynomial is zero exactly if the 3 points are collinear. Okay, so one can find such a polynomial, such an equation. And then the question becomes, can we choose 3 sets, or maybe it's the same set, but can we choose 3 sets, A, B, C, that intersect the zero set of this polynomial in n squared points. Because this is, so we know that this is at least n squared. Okay? So the fact that there are n squared, constant times n squared, three-rich lines lying on this, spanned by the points that line on this curve, can be reformulated as we have three sets. We look at their Cartesian product. We look at the two-dimensional algebraic surface in R2. And the number of points of this Cartesian product that lies on this on the zero set of the surface is very large. It's more or less n squared. And this is the maximum maximal number. So again, this is a concrete problem. But we know to answer this more general question about the constant degree algebraic surface. And again, what we show is that locally, it's a result. So OK, I'll give the credits in a minute. But we can show that locally, if there are n squared points here, locally, this surface can be described in this form. And the fact that this surface can be described in this case in this form allows us to find this triangular grid very easily, because we can choose the sets here to be arithmetic progressions and then get this triangular grid and get that many points lie on a cubic curve. And then since it's an irreducible curve, just to say that it lies on the curve. So, but still, there is something more general here, right? Because we have a surface, we have points, and we get this triangular grid. But now this triangular grid appears not only in the case of the problem of three-rich lines. So if instead of this question you can put here something else, we will always get the triangular grid. And the challenge will be, I'm trying to say that there is a recipe for more general problems. If you have another problem, you get a dichotomy between two cases. In one of the cases, you will get this triangular grid, and you will need to identify what it means in the concrete context. And in this context, it turns out to be a cubic curve. Sorry for taking the time. That's it. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much.